welcome Jürgen Schmidhuber.
Three prisoners were sentenced to death, one of them French, one of them German, one of them American. "What is your last wish?" they ask the French guy. He says, "One exquisite bottle of exquisite French wine." "What is your last wish?" they ask the German guy. He says, "I want to give a speech." "What is your last wish?" they ask the American guy. He says, "I want to get shot before the German starts his speech." Unfortunately for you guys, it is too late now. Up there is the title of my talk, and this is my name. This is how to pronounce my name. And all the things I'm going to talk about are in many papers on web pages, and you can get overviews more than you wish if you go to these pages or Google for keywords. I'm affiliated with the ITSEA, the Swiss AI Lab in Lugano. And I also have a group at the Technische Universität München, Tech University Munich, where there are a couple of pioneering robots. All my slides are designed according to recursive applications of the harmonic proportion, the golden ratio, and that makes them very compressible, and therefore has a lot to do with my talk, because it's all about compression and compression progress. But before I come to that, let me just make a few general comments. Lots of people, especially at this conference, are talking about the future, but it's much harder to shape the future. And I'm going to show you a shaper. Here we see him. He was mentioned before. Markus Hutter, a couple of years ago, did a postdoc in my lab in Switzerland. But now he's a professor in Canberra, and he came up with this algorithm that every computer scientist should know, a universal problem-solving algorithm, which takes any well-defined problem as an input and computes the solution to this problem as quickly as the fastest unknown algorithm for solving that type of problem, that provably solves that type of problem. So that's an amazing algorithm. The only slowdown, there is a little bit of a slowdown, which is just a constant slowdown. So it's as fast as the fastest method, except for an additive constant that disappears as the problems get larger and larger. As, for example, you are trying to solve a traveling salesman problem, and the number of cities gets larger and larger, this additive constant becomes negligible. And so we can say that today, most problems are solved because most large problems are solved, because almost all problems are large problems, and there are just a few small problems. And the only reason why this is not the computer science end is that that within this universe, there are lots of small problems that are so small that the additive constant, which hides the complexity, the constant effort requested by a proof-searching technique, it hides it, in this universe, these constants still are relevant because the problems are so small. Now, can you do anything about these constants? Yes, you can use an old trick of Kurt Gödel, who in 1931 founded theoretical computer science. You can produce a self-referential Gödel machine. I will tell you something about that in a second. Here we see a picture of Gödel, and he, in 1931, used the integers as a universal programming language, and he used it to describe or to create formulas that talk about themselves, that are self-referential, and they say things such as, "I am not provable by a computational theorem proving procedure," and in this way, he showed that math is either fundamentally flawed or contains statements that are true but not provable. And he was an Austrian. He did this work in Vienna, but later he came to the United States, just like another great Austrian thinker who then became governor of California. And we can use the self-reference trick of Gödel to build another type of optimal universal problem solver, which is totally self-referential in the sense that it can inspect any of its code and can rewrite any of its code, provided that it first can show through a proof that the rewrite is good according to some user-defined utility function, which can be anything. Any problem can be written if it is well-defined as a utility function. And so we have a self-referential machine. This is a rather novel application of Gödel's self-reference trick, which can be used to build a universal problem solver, which again is theoretically optimal in a certain sense. And if you really want to understand the details of that, you can download pages and papers on this. But here I just want to point out that we are currently entering, through results like that, into a phase where AI, artificial intelligence, is not any longer just a collection of heuristics, but it is becoming a real formal science, like probability theory and established sciences like that. And that's good, because heuristics come and go, but theorems are for eternity. And this reminds me that in just a few months, we will have the next Artificial General Intelligence Conference in Lugano. The first two were here in the United States. And the deadline for submitting papers is 15th October, I believe. Now, the main message of my talk is that any understanding of intelligence would be incomplete without an understanding of things such as art and science and music and humor. And I will show you, that there's a very simple algorithmic principle that can explain these things. It's so simple that it fits on a single slide, in principle. So that is now the most important slide of my entire talk. It contains my take-home message for you. If you understand that slide, you understood everything. There are still people coming in from lunch. Maybe I should wait a little bit until everybody's seated. But what should an unsupervised, intelligent agent, be it a human baby or an artificial agent, what should it do? How should it deal with the data that is streaming in through the input sensors in response to the actions that it's executing? But first of all, and this is a very trivial thing to do in principle at least, is you should store all the data that is coming in. You shouldn't throw away any of the data if you can. And it makes sense, because within a couple of years we will be able to store 100 years of lifetime at the resolution of a high-definition TV video. And maybe human brains also can store 100 years of human lifetime at the rate of maybe, I once made a rough calculation of about, well, comparably to a low-resolution MPEG video. So in principle, that is not a problem, but with that by itself, you cannot do anything. You have to find regularities in this history of inputs and actions that you store, and in other words, you have to compress it. You have to compress the history. Whenever there's a regularity, a symmetry, or whatever, then you can write a program that needs less bits than the raw data and still encodes the entire data. So that's what compression is about. Now, let's define the simplicity or the subjective compressibility or the subjective beauty of some data point X, given some subjective observer O at a given point in his life, T. And that is just the number of bits you need to